Greetings, MelVee family. A warm welcome to this week's Bible study lesson. I'm so delighted that you have been able to join us and you've been following these lessons. And this week we are on lesson 8 and we are discussing some of the challenges that we face as we follow Jesus. And to help me discuss this lesson is Refilwe. Greetings and welcome.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I'm happy to be here. We meet again. We were doing lesson 2 together. I'm happy we're doing lesson 8 together.
Great stuff. Shall we pray as we get into this lesson together? Maybe pray for us if you may.
Thank you, Jesus, for your loving kindness. We know that everything you do for us exudes love. And we thank you for the opportunity to discuss your word with your children. Speak to our hearts. Direct our tongues, dear God. Our minds must be channeled according to the way that you want us to go. There's someone we are going to encourage. Open the eyes and the mind of that person. And we ask that whatever we are going to say, that we say it the way you would have said it, full of love. We thank you, Jesus. In your name we have prayed. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. So last week, the panel were looking at part one of the teaching by Jesus to the disciples. This week looks like we are also focusing on perhaps very close and personal areas that impact us as we follow Jesus. And it's clear that some of these include marriage. Some of them include how we raise our children and how we teach them and what God has to say about children. But also it looks at the healing of another blind man. We had a healing of the blind man last week. But we have another one. But this one is a very special reference. And the memory text we are exploring here is Mark 10, verse 45. Could I ask you to perhaps read that for us and maybe share your overview of the lesson as well?
It says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served. That's powerful. But to serve and to give his life as ransom for many.
Amen.
I was interested at the last word, for many. I wondered why did it not say for all. But maybe there is a discussion for a different platform. But the important thing here that Jesus is saying, as I'm summarizing verse 45 of chapter 10, he's saying, I'm here to live my life for you guys. I'm not here to live my life for me. That whatever I do, I'm here to serve you. It's such a beautiful example, a simple example that we can start to actualize in our own lives. Who have we served this past week? Have we served someone in the family? Have we served someone in the street? Have we served someone? Or has the week just been about us? So let's remember these words. Jesus says, I have not come here to be served. And by the way, he deserves all the service, by the way. I must underline that because he is the creator.
He's the Son of God.
He's the Son of God. He deserves to be served. But he says, I didn't come here for that. But I'm here for you. I'm here to serve you who are here on.
So the chapter 10 opens with the context of where he is. And the first teaching he gives perhaps to his disciples is one that affects many of us. And I know we're limited on time. I've done some lectures on this particular section where I have taught about marriage and divorce and remarriage because it is addressed in just about
in that sequence,
12 verses. And so it says, and he arose from where he was. He was in Capernaum and cometh into the coasts of Judea by the further side of the Jordan. And the people resort unto him again. And he, and as he was wont, he taught them again. And he opens up by teaching based on the question asked by the Pharisees. The question is it lawful for a man to put away his wife. Mark adds this scripture saying, tempting him.
Mm.
So Jesus yes. begins his teaching by asking a question. What does Moses say?
Yeah.
And I think I like that style, because what they are addressing here is not just the dissolution of the marriage, but the loss of an institution and all its benefits, and how do I then deal with it? And maybe how do I behave? And they say, no, Moses said, write a bill of divorcement and send them away. Mm. But listen to Jesus' teaching.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping it will help someone out there. Verse 5, and Jesus answered and said, for the hardness of your heart, he wrote you this precept.
Mm.
So the issue was never about divorce.
Mm.
It was never about sending the woman away.
Yeah.
It had everything to do with the condition of your heart.
Mm.
I'm reminded of Malachi.
Yeah.
That says a man fills his heart with violence when he divorces his wife. So it's not the act of sending the wife away.
Yeah.
It is what happens, or what is the state of your mind.
Yeah.
I'm pointing at the heart, but I'm...
Yeah. It's the same thing.
The state of your mind or the heart. So I'm talking about your understanding of the teachings, or not even the teaching, the intention of God, the motive of God for creating Adam and Eve and bringing them together and saying they are one. Now, I like what verse 6 says, because it brings out the thought of God.
Yeah.
It says, verse 6, but from the beginning of the creation of God, where he made the male and female, okay? For this cause shall man leave his father and his mother and cleave to his wife.
Mm.
Who's leaving?
The man is leaving. Yeah.
Because Adam left the hands of God.
Mm.
And when God made Eve, God never said anything.
Mm.
He just made Eve and opened his eyes.
Mm. Yeah. An interesting reaction.
Hear me well on this one before you come in. He opened his eyes and Adam did the rest.
Mm.
So he left and cleaved too.
Yeah.
You wanted to say something?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I was saying it was an interesting reaction
he
gave when he saw this marvelous being who was actually another of himself.
Yes. Yeah.
And this is why perhaps the cleaving was not difficult because he was not cleaving to a foreign body.
Mm.
Eve was part of him.
Him.
Already.
Yeah.
I wanted to say that you talked about dissolution of marriage and what happens to us, or the effect of the dissolution. And sometimes when we talk about how God hates divorce, perhaps we should extend and say God hates what happens to us when we are going through divorce or after divorce, because it is such a hateful process.
Yeah.
And God does not like to see his children suffer in that way. Because he knows, and when God created this institution, it was an institution not just to demonstrate selflessness or being about the next person, but it was an institution where we had an opportunity together to grow together so that we can be like God.
God, exactly. Now, Malachi speaks on this topic where he says God could have given Adam another one because he had a residue of spirit. Then he says, for the Lord, on verse 16 of Malachi chapter 2, for the Lord, the God of Israel, saith, he hates putting away. Because in the beginning it was not so. When he brought them together, his intention was huge. It was supposed to be, Romans 1 says, we see the invisible God, even the power of God in that which was created, which includes marriage of a husband and a wife. Then he says, for one covereth violence, or he covers his garments with violence, says the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit that you deal not treacherously. So his address to these people was not to do with the bill of divorcement. Mm. In answering their question, is it lawful?
Yeah.
It's not even an issue of the law. It's an issue of how is this impacting your heart when you send that woman away?
Yeah.
Because the verse in Malachi then says, you're filling your garment, which is your character, by the way, with violence.
Yeah.
And so divorce changes people in ways that they never would have thought anything could change them.
Yeah.
And so Jesus addresses that.
I want to go back to the question that they ask. Mm-hmm. Is it lawful?
Yes.
And I ask myself, why are they not saying, is it right? Which tells me there must be a difference.
Yes.
Is it lawful? Mm-hmm. Is it right?
Is it right?
So they chose their words very carefully.
Yeah, it says they were tempting him.
Yeah, is it lawful? Because it's possible for something to be lawful, but not necessarily right.
Yeah.
It is lawful because it has been voted. Like now we've just had elections. There's going to be parliament.
Yeah.
When people, when the majority votes that something is lawful, it may not necessarily be the right thing at that time. So I thought that was a very interesting choice of words.
Very.
Is it lawful?
And by the way, they are taking it from a written scripture, Deuteronomy 24, where the bill of divorcement is explained.
It's coming from.
And so Jesus then says, that's not even the issue. Mm. In fact, let me tell you, Moses did that because your hearts were stiff-necked.
Mm.
You are of a stony heart, which is selfish.
Yeah.
And so when we go through marriage, and by the way, we don't create marriage for ourselves to save us. It's so that we can save others.
Yes.
If you go into your marriage to be saved by marriage, it will kick you out.
Yeah.
Because marriage is about the other person.
Mm.
That's why Adam had to leave the hand of God and be with Eve.
Mm.
And Adam was to provide, was to be the priest, was to be the leader, and was to contribute to the procreation of the child.
Mm.
But the woman was a better creature that God created. So Jesus goes back. I'm tempted to teach a little bit more, but I know time is up. But Jesus goes back. The point I'm making is he didn't address the issue of the law.
Mm.
He addressed the spirit of the law.
Yes.
Why God did it that way.
Yeah.
And why in the beginning he never intended.
Yeah.
And that's why in Malachi he says he hates it.
Yeah.
Not that he hates the divorcee or the divorcer, but he hates that process because it destroys a lot of things.
Destroys a lot of things.
Yeah.
You've heard, before we go on to the next day, there is a phrase that sometimes we use where somebody say that, you know this one, I had big plans for them. That's what God had when he gave us marriage.
Exactly.
Said, these people, I have such big, beautiful plans for them. Let me give them this gift. The gift of,
and that's why marriage was made for men.
Yes.
The Sabbath was made for men. And in fact, he said, let us make men in our own image and let's give them dominion.
Mm.
And this dominion, when you look at what God intended, it was dominion not over each other.
Yes, yes.
The issue of thinking men are more important than women. Yeah. Eve was not created to be under.
Yes.
Even as God was punishing them, God still endeared Eve to the husband.
Mm.
Your desire shall be that of.
Mm.
And so God's intention was a perpetual, eternal covenant relationship where the other serves the other one.
Yes.
And mutually, selflessly, their spirits are drawn to each other.
And it was not meant to be a painful process. You know, some of us, serving somebody else is such a foreign thing. We feel disrespected when we have to serve someone. But it's actually such a high calling.
Yeah.
And you see it when Jesus repeats it in verse 45. I have not come to be served.
Yes.
Rather, I have come to serve.
Yes.
And the verse goes on to say, show you that I've come to save you, I give myself as ransom.
Yeah.
Not for me, not for you.
So he concludes this teaching by saying, I think later on the disciples came to him and said, Master, what do you say there? You left us worried.
Yeah.
So they asked him again, asked him again the same matter. Please clarify.
Mm.
Then you know what he says? When you put away your wife, whoever puts away his wife and marries another, because that's always the intention. I'm done with this one. Mm. I think I want something new. Commits adultery against her.
Yeah.
And then he says, and if a woman shall put away her husband and be married to another, she commits adultery.
Mm.
I always say when I speak on this one, I don't know what my listeners think out there. If we were to audit our marriages today based on this verse, many of our so-called couples today are committing adultery. But I'm not there to judge.
Yeah.
It is the Lord who judges. Because Jesus knew. The reason why your heart wants to put this one away is because you want to get another one.
Mm.
And God says, no, the covenant of marriage is perpetual until Jesus comes.
Yeah.
And so that's one big aspect he teaches on this week's lesson to the disciples.
Mm.
So the issue of adultery was only revealed to the disciples.
At a later time.
But let's move on and talk about Jesus and children.
Jesus.
We are products of these marriages.
Of the marriage. And I like the order that there is a marriage.
Yes.
And then there's a discussion about children.
Out, yes.
The lesson enlightens us and tells us that during that time, children were actually not esteemed as they should have been.
Mm.
To a point that some were regarded at the level of slaves.
Yeah, products.
Yeah, they were just...
Assets.
Yeah. And this is why in this part of chapter 10 of Mark, when children are in their midst, the disciples start to get irritated.
Mm.
Get these people or small people
or
out.
This
is not their place.
Names,
But Jesus does something different.
Mm.
Not only does he approach them and stands close to them, he actually embraces some of them. And he says, but actually, if you go to, I think, either Mark 9 or Mark 10, where he says that the kingdom of God is for those who are like these ones.
In fact, he says it, on verse chapter 10, verse 14. But when Jesus saw it, when the disciples were rebuking them and throwing them out, he was much displeased and said unto them, much displeased. Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily, verily, I say to you, whosoever, now he's applying it to life, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein.
Yes, yes. So he is showing them that their thoughts about children has been so distorted.
Yes.
That what their behavior towards children is actually unacceptable. And this is why it says Jesus was very, very upset.
Mm.
The point that I want to bring here is Jesus is saying that at the end of the day, these are members of your community.
Yep.
They come from, they did not fall from trees.
Mm.
They come from your own families.
Yes.
So they needed to be treated as members of the community. You can't decide that they're not important all of a sudden. And this is and he's approaching them and embracing them is something that they would not have done.
Yeah.
Because they are used to chasing children out of their presence. But Jesus says, no, these actually you have to bring them closer. How else will you teach them if you discard them? Remove them from your presence.
In fact, it actually ends by saying, after he had said what he said, he took them upon his arms and put his hands upon them and blessed them.
Which is what we should be doing.
As parents,
There is a quote from Ministry of Healing from Ellen White, page 43 and 44. I want to read it so that I don't want to paraphrase it. It's talking to me as a parent, as an aunt, or as an uncle out there, or as a sister.
Yes.
Let not your unchrist-like character misinterpret Jesus.
Mm.
Do not keep the little ones away from him by your coldness and harshness.
Wow.
Never give them cause to feel that heaven would not be a pleasant place for them. if they were not there. Do not speak of religion as something that children cannot understand. My mind went to Jeremiah.
Yes.
Or act as if they were not expected to accept Christ in their childhood. Don't treat them like they're not smart. Then she continues to say, do not give them false impression that the religion of Christ is the religion of gloom, and that in coming to the Savior they must give up all that makes life joyful.
Wow.
So the admonition here is that we need to be careful how we treat children.
We should treat them as members of the kingdom, like you said, and invest a lot in them. True. Amen. Thank you so much. But let's talk about this other experience Jesus has in Mark chapter 10. I think it's from verse 17 to 31. The lesson calls it the best investment. The young man comes to Jesus. I think I'm going to read from verse 17, where it says, the young, and when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him. So this was important to this man. Good master, what must I do that I may inherit eternal life? Again, Jesus starts answering by a question. I think the teaching I'm getting there is that the great minds ask questions.
Ask the right questions.
The right questions so that by asking, they will help the person to discover the answer that they already have inside. Adam, where are you? Not that God couldn't see him. So he then says, why callest me good? There's none good but one, that is God. Again, he goes back to the commandments. You know the narrative. I'm sure our listeners know the story. But here is what it says at the end. He went away. That's verse 22. And he was sad at that saying. And went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And then Jesus makes a remark about the rich people. I wish I had friends with rich people, actually, because I need their money for ministry. Not that I'm throwing them away. Maybe they should give the position. He says, how hard shall they that have riches to enter the kingdom of God?
And he asks the question twice. He asks the question twice. Perhaps the first time the disciples were still mulling over the question, but he says, hey, I have asked a question. How difficult will it be for rich people to enter the kingdom of God? And he uses a metaphor of a camel and the eye of the needle.
The needle, yes.
And you can look at it in two ways. You can look at it as an actual needle and an actual camel. Or you can look at it, it is, if you go and research a little bit, you'll find that there was a place actually that existed that was called the eye of the needle. And it was a place where
camels can't come into the city.
Yes, because the load.
Walk in.
Correct. So he's using that metaphor. But the relief comes when he himself answers the question.
Yes, to the disciples.
Because
it affected them, isn't it?
Yes, because their posture when they ask the question, then if the rich people cannot be saved, who then will be saved? And Jesus
then had to explain.
It says, what is impossible with man
is possible
with God.
With God.
So that saying spells hope for me. That actually Jesus is saying the rich won't enter heaven. That's not what he's saying. It may be a difficult journey. But he says, God can make it possible.
If they surrender.
Yes.
To God.
If they surrender. Similarly with poor people.
But actually, I have a question and I'm wondering. He went away aggrieved. Could it be that later on it made sense to him?
It's possible. It's possible because we hear of him for the last time at that point where he leaves.
Aggrieved.
And his heart is heavy because he owns a lot. And we are not told whether...
if God ever visited
him. Yeah, whether he
yeah.
The message yeah. made... Which says, here's another lesson, mm-hmm. that says that we shouldn't conclude about the lives of people, about the salvation of people, because we don't know the conversations yes. they're having in their secret closet with
yes.
God. We should be yes. very careful. It is possible that the words of Jesus rang in his mind,
yeah.
and he said, actually, yeah. I really want this eternal life. Let me sell everything. We don't know, but many of us have written him off. And have already concluded he will never see the kingdom.
I think I would
heaven.
Like to have rich friends. So if you are rich out there, please get in touch with me. Because look at Jesus being, when yeah. he was nailed to the cross, who actually helped the disciples to get the body?
It was the rich man
who said, actually bring him here, apply all the wrappings. And he had a grave already prepared,
yeah.
which he borrowed to Jesus for 2 nights. You know.
That's an incredible story. There's a quote from one of Ellen White's books that says, I'm paraphrasing what she says, mm-hmm. that resources and money are such a powerful tool if
yes,
they're in the hands of the right person.
Absolutely.
Or the right people. Yeah. So there's nothing wrong with being rich.
Yeah.
There was nothing wrong with the rich young ruler.
Mm.
Perhaps the only thing he needed to do was to change his perspective and realize
yes.
that the resources that are put in his hands were actually meant to edify
yes.
the kingdom
yeah.
of God.
I even read somewhere where Ellen White addresses the issue of saying, if a rich man who doesn't believe in God brings riches to us, should we accept them? And she says, absolutely.
Yes.
Because God owns everything.
Yes.
And the direction of the giving here by Jesus was not to himself.
Mm.
And I want to address another point. We have men of God, quotes, but actually they are men of gold, who tell people, sow a seed.
Yeah.
And they collect billions of dollars from people.
Yeah, they buy Maseratis.
For themselves, buy Maseratis and buy
these helicopters.
Jets and yeah. And yet, in this case, Jesus did not say, go sell and bring it to me.
Yeah.
He says,
give to the poor.
So he was actually calling him to get into ministry.
Yeah.
So as a rich person, how much of your wealth are you giving to the poor? Because remember, the judgment, when he shall come, is he will not ask you how many Maseratis you have,
yeah.
or how many Lamborghinis, and
yeah.
how many boats you had, or yachts, or whatever, or how many mansions, and how many buildings. No, he will say, you saw me poor.
Yeah, what did you do?
I was hungry. I was naked. I was in hospital. I was in prison.
What did you do?
So how did you use your wealth?
Yeah.
I thought that was a very fascinating.
There's an important point we have to make here before we close Wednesday. Somebody may think that, okay, if it is difficult for the rich to enter heaven, it means it's easy for the poor to enter heaven. Or maybe it is an automatic thing. We have to correct that.
Yeah.
That is not what is
yeah.
being said here.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is saying that God is able to avail grace for anybody.
Exactly.
Whether you are poor, whether
you
are
rich. Yes.
It is by grace that we get to inherit eternal life.
So it looks like our relationship with wealth or the lack thereof does impact our spirituality.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah.
You went away aggrieved, you didn't see the value. But again, the poor need to be served and they depend on God for receiving. But I want us to move further and talk about the question that is asked from Mark chapter 10, verse 32-45. I want us to quickly wrap it up because I want us to also focus on the other question.
Yeah.
What do you want me to do for you?
Sure, this one. Can you drink my cup?
Yeah, can you drink my cup? The point there was what they had asked, isn't it? Maybe walk us through why did he ask this question?
So
this is Jesus asking.
His own disciples.
Yeah.
And I was trying to imagine how the group is walking, but it seemed that they were able to isolate Jesus, the two of them, and say, Master, can we ask you a big favor? I'm paraphrasing.
Yes.
Please put us on either side of yourself. And Jesus again asks the question.
Yeah.
Can you drink my cup?
Because that position is taken by those who should drink.
Yeah. And they eagerly, without any thought, they said, yes. And it seemed like they were prophesying their own lives. So we need to be careful how we speak.
What we ask for.
What we ask for.
It will wait for us in future.
Yes. And Jesus says, done. Yeah. Actually, you are going to drink the cup.
Wow.
And we are told that one was martyred. I think it was James who was martyred.
Yes.
John was exiled to Patmos.
Thrown into the temple.
Yeah. But he was exiled after he was tortured. So that was them drinking the cup.
He lived longer.
And he lived. He lived longer. Yes.
Yeah.
The interesting part that Jesus does not leave out is, it is not for me though
to decide
whether any of you should be on the left or the right. Those places are left for those who have been prepared by God. So
I think Jesus there was just being humble because judgment has been given to him.
Yeah.
And Revelation says, whoever overcomes will sit with me.
Yes.
I overcame.
Yes. But the issue here is the motivation behind the question.
Yes.
It was never to do with the kingdom of God. This was a question that was driven by ego.
Yes.
I want to look good. I want to have a title that says, I'm the right man. I'm the right hand man of Jesus. So maybe there was nothing wrong with the request, but the motive was displaced.
Totally wrong.
It was about them and not really about the kingdom of God. So we need to be. Very circumspect, very careful. The things that we do, the things that we say, it's always good to check the heart, check the motive. Why are you asking for a particular thing? Why are you on a particular quest? Why are you on this mission? Is it for you or is it for other reasons?
I would say don't create a career out of your ministry. Just save God. Don't aspire to be high. And this is what destroys our ministry.
Yeah.
And I want to talk specifically perhaps to pastors. And I don't have time for this. You were called to serve, not to be served. So careerism is destroying this very point.
Yeah.
People are still asking today to sit on the high seat. And there's campaigning. There's conniving.
Yes.
There's caucusing.
Yes.
There's pushing.
Yeah, lobbying
and all of this. And we are still doing exactly what the disciples did. And that was one of Jesus' biggest discouragements with his disciples, that they are seeking earthly progress.
Yes.
But let's talk about what do you want me to do for you.
Wait, before what do you want me to do for you, there's a very powerful leadership answer that Jesus gives. If you want to be first, you have to be last.
Yes.
Put it differently, if you want to be above,
you have to toe the line. Yeah.
Be the one
below. Don't go and sit on the high
seat. Don't be in the front first. Learn to pull from the back.
Yes.
Learn to serve.
Yeah.
So what I'm getting Jesus is saying here to anyone, whether you are in leadership at your workplace or at home or maybe you don't have a title but you know you're a leader by right.
Yes.
Service is the best leadership that you can ever display.
This is our core text for this week.
Yeah.
10:45. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered to, but to minister and to give life as a ransom to many.
That's true. There's a quote that says, if serving is below you, then leadership is beyond you. So if you are not prepared to serve, do not lead.
Yes.
The two go together.
Yeah. But then what do you want me to do for you? Is another question that he asks from Mark chapter 10, verse 46. I'm not going to read all of it because of time. But this is blind Bartimaeus.
It's a powerful
question. We are in Jericho now.
Yeah.
All right? And Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, he was by the highway begging. And then the guy heard that Jesus of Nazareth is passing by and he began to cry out. And look at how he called him,
son of David.
Have mercy on me.
Yeah.
And some told him, shh, hold your peace. But he cried even louder, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Then finally Jesus heard him and said, bring him here. Okay. And he asked him the question, what will thou that I should do for you?
That's like giving him a blank check.
Yes.
Write the amount that you want.
Wow.
On the check, and whatever you've written,
yeah,
you're gonna get.
Yeah.
That's how I pictured it. But
and he said that I may see.
Mm.
He knew exactly what he wanted.
Yes, which was very quick, because I want to believe the experience that he had as a blind man was not a good one.
Mm.
But here he meets his salvation. This was a salvation day for him.
Wow.
And he sees, because Jesus spoke it, that now it's okay. Mm. Your vision can be restored.
Mm.
This actually is deeper than what we read here.
Yeah.
Remember when we began chapter 10,
yeah,
we started with a family setting,
maybe
a relationship between a man and a woman.
Yes.
Then we came to children. Then we came to how we regard resources and riches.
Yeah.
And then we came to how we regard ourselves in terms of ego.
Mm.
I believe that this part, this part of chapter 10 about Bartimaeus is about opening of the proverbial vision. It wasn't just about the physical eyes. For me, what this chapter is saying is that if you want to remedy the ills that you experience in marriage, that you experience with the abuse of children, the ills of
materialism,
and all these you have isms. To fix the vision. The vision has been distorted. This is why all of these problems we are experiencing. So Jesus is saying the antidote, the remedy of that is the eyesight. So Bartimaeus is, the story of Bartimaeus is actually a loaded story for me. And it reminds me, in chapter 8, we learned about another blind man.
Yeah.
Again, this was a lesson to the disciples.
Mm.
That blind man, Jesus touched twice. Mm. The first time, the blind man says, I can see, but they are like
hazy.
People, it's a hazy view. Yeah. And Jesus touched him again. And then he says, okay, now I can see. The difference in that account, the man did not shout like Bartimaeus. But Jesus touched the man. For Bartimaeus asked
specifically
for Jesus and asked to be, and Jesus didn't touch him.
Mm.
But perhaps that's a story for another day. The important thing is,
he said, go your way.
Yes.
Your faith has made you whole.
Has made you whole.
Wow.
Without touching him. He just said, go your way. Your faith has made you whole. Mm. But the point here is the distorted vision has to be corrected.
My sister, I think you're touching something that is so deep.
Mm.
Because the very first temptation in the Garden of Eden was Eve's eyesight being changed.
Mm.
Until he sees this fruit as a good one.
Yeah.
I was telling my family the other day, and I was saying, why is it that when you blink, you don't see darkness?
Yeah.
You continue
there's
seeing.
There's no blackout.
Yeah, there's no blackout because there's a retina.
Yeah. And I thought it was because of the speed of your...
No, the speed does contribute, yes, but there's a retina that retains an iconic... Yeah, it's an iconic memory that the brain continues seeing. So we blink and we continue seeing because it's recorded.
Mm.
And Eve, when she had a conversation, when we have conversations, why I prefer children not to use electronic media, but to actually read the words, is because when they read, the mind is creating mental pictures of what they are reading.
Yes.
And that's what we recall. And so in many cases, why we change our perspectives is because the inside mind, the inside eye has been opened. Mm. When the Bible says, then their eyes were opened, it's not that because they were not seeing before.
Yes.
But there's an eye of understanding, of visualization that gets opened. And I guess what I hear you saying is, if our eyes of the mind and the spirit are closed, our marriages will be broken. That's what Jesus is saying.
Yeah.
And our relationship with material will be always broken.
Yes.
We won't see God. We won't see ourselves as stewards.
Yes.
And we won't see the role of God in our materials.
Correct.
And again, on our physical health.
Yeah.
We've got to realize that when I eat, when I drink, when I rest and I keep the laws of health, my eyes are actually being opened so I can see things differently.
Yeah.
And that's a beautiful one.
I just had a thought that have we ever asked ourselves why we dream in pictures? I've never heard of anyone who said my dream was just an audio.
That's why I said the mind is visual.
Yes.
The mind is an eye.
Yes.
The mind is an eye. It sees. Mm. It hears. All the senses feed the big eye called the mind.
Wow. So this is why Paul says in Romans chapter, is it Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2?
Mm-hmm.
I want to read it.
I beseech you, brethren, that you may give yourselves as a living sacrifice to God, and that you may be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Yes.
Yeah.
This
be
is
transformed
it.
Transformed by the renewing of your mind.
This is it.
That's
this
the sight we need.
Yes. This is what the story of Bartimaeus is trying to tell us.
Amen. Amen. I love that perspective. Mm-hmm. And I think, let's wrap it up. Your closing remarks of Jesus' teaching on this hierarchy of needs and issues that affect us in our life. What's your closing
remarks? My conclusion of this week's lesson, even the lessons that came before this one.
Mm-hmm.
God is saying to me, Refilwe, your life is not about you. Your life is about other people who are around you.
Mm.
And if I work to esteem those who are around me, in a roundabout way, I'll end up being served.
Mm.
I don't know if you understand.
Yeah.
But once I begin to focus on me and block out the vision of other people, that's where things start to go wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's when my ego has become more important.
Mm.
When my survival, and we talk about survival of the fittest, there is no such thing in the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
When everything has to shift so that I can benefit. Perhaps, in fact, if we have not done it, we need to start doing it. We need to now start focusing on other people, start esteeming other people, uplifting other people, doing things for other people. It shouldn't be a strange thing to serve others. And it takes us back to the memory text.
Amen.
Jesus, who says that I have come to actually serve you.
Amen. Viewers, that's all we had for you this week. May the Lord bless you. Remember, before you go, leave your comments below. Ask your questions below. Let us know what you think about this, and we'll be happy to hear from you. Remember to like, to share, and to subscribe. Let's close with a word of prayer. Would you kindly pray for us, Sister Filo?
We thank you, Jesus, for the story of Bartimaeus. You have revealed to us, it is so plain what we need to do. We need to transform by renewing the mind, the eye of the mind, and we are asking for you to help us, because we know it's not going to be an easy journey, because there are things we have to forego. There are things we have to give up so that we can serve others, so that we can esteem others. But you have promised, as you were talking to Peter when he raised the question, that we have been following you, but we are still poor. And your answer was, it is not for nothing. All in the end will be replenished. And we ask, dear God, that you may give us a right perspective, a new perspective for some of us, and lead us in the right direction. And we want to follow you. Where we fall, we pray you pick us up. Where our vision is distorted, we pray you fix it. Where we are not heading in the right direction, we ask that you redirect us, Holy Spirit. We ask that you may also open the minds of the viewers, whoever needs to hear this, Lord, let this lesson land on them by one way or the other. We know they will be enriched. We know they'll be encouraged as well. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.